Hi, everyone. Thank you for joining us for today's NADA webinar. My name is Ashley Smith from NADA, and I will be your host. From all of us at the National Automobile Dealers Association, we're happy to have you. Today's webinar will be recorded and available on NADA's website at nada.org/education. As a quick reminder, NADA Education is an online resource and learning tool available to you and your entire team as a free member benefit. Every one of your staff members can create their own login and access over 500 online resources today, including NADA Show 2020 workshop recordings. We have an hour scheduled for this webinar, including Q&A. Please type any questions you have for our presenter into the Q&A panel. You can find this located at the bottom of your screen at any time during the presentation. At the end, we'll ask as many questions as we can in the time allotted. Our topic today is the art of ROI, how to drive pre-owned sales profits. Our presenter today is Pete Margaros, Senior Dealer Relations Manager at Automotive Mastermind. Pete, thanks so much for joining us today. Why don't you go ahead and kick us off?
My pleasure. Thank you so much, Ashley, for having me. And on behalf of our company at Automotive Mastermind, we're very excited to be part of this continuing education series with NADA. A little bit about me. I've been with Mastermind for almost 3 years. I've been in the business for a long time, for 25 plus years. I've focused really on at-risk stores and retention. I've worked in sales management. I've worked in the finance side of the business, both in retail as well in non-retail, on the OEM side, the vendor side, and even the association side. On a personal note, it's nice to get back to NADA in a virtual sense because I did spend some time there on the dealer operations side. So it's kind of a homecoming in some ways for me, but I've got over 20 years in the automotive business. I've worked at large companies like Nissan and Infiniti and big data companies like Experian and Equifax, and like I said, even for NADA. Heavy focus on the pre-owned side of the business, but I've touched a lot of sides of this particular industry. Very, very excited to be part of this continuing education series. So let's talk a little bit about pre-owned and where we're at now. This has been an interesting. We hear the word pandemic a lot. And we've heard the word unrest a lot. And we've heard a lot of different things about 2020 that a lot of us have never seen in our lifetimes, if any of us have. And the market has definitely shifted in a lot of ways, and it's changed in a lot of ways, at least in 2020. There's a flood of used vehicles entering the market, and that poses a unique opportunity for dealers to, number one, adapt to new vehicle inventory challenges, and number two, accelerate auto sales after the crisis. For example, in April, many dealers were approaching trade-ins with caution, given the collapsing retail demand and dropping wholesale prices. Now, dealers are scrambling to find used cars because of new car inventory shortages and surging demand for used vehicles by consumers. Used inventory is down because of this. If we had only known, but like any pandemic, it's an extremely volatile market and one none of us have seen in our generation. 33% of those not delaying a vehicle purchase call this really a smart time to buy a car. So there is amazing opportunity in the industry. Let's take a look at some of the numbers. As we look at new vehicle sales, we saw obviously what happened in March when the pandemic really hit, and as a result of what happened in April. But as we heard from folks like the CEO at Ford yesterday, who actually had an interview with CNN, and one of the comments he made is he was amazed at how quickly the industry has rebounded. And as you can see the numbers, April was certainly down, but May and June bounced back in a pretty big way. And as we get through the rest of the year, providing things stay where they're at, we should see a stabilization of the industry. And yes, by the time we finish the end of 2020, we will certainly be down from a new vehicle sales forecast, but it's not nearly as bad as we thought back in March and April. There is a positive movement throughout the end of the year, because dealers have really gotten through what we would call the hard part. But as we think about pre-owned and we look at where those levels are, a really interesting statistic that caught my eye is that in this particular report, it looks at the total number of used vehicles sold compared to new since January of 2018. You can see a massive uptick in April of this year. For example, in March, there were actually less used vehicles sold as compared to new. But as we move through April and May, especially in May, there's 3 used vehicles sold for every new vehicle that's sold in the market. So this really represents a great opportunity. It encompasses all used vehicle transactions, and the industry's new-to-used ratio is the highest in those 3 months since the start of 2018, from February, April, and May of this year. And consumers tend to shift their focus to the used vehicle market during those times of financial distress. We saw it back in 08, for those of you that remember the crash from a financial perspective. Although we didn't have the same reason behind the crash this year, the behavior is very similar. So the state of pre-owned sales, as we kind of peel the onion a little bit, we look at things like wholesale auctions. So for example, in mid-July, wholesale auction sales were 98,000 units in the week ending August 2nd, 2,000 below the pre-virus forecast for the week. But wholesale auction prices improved for the 15th consecutive week, rising 0.6 of a basis point for the week ending August 2nd. Prices have grown 34% over the past 15 weeks and are actually now 14% higher than the index baseline from March 1st. Sales of those used vehicles at franchise dealers have beat the pre-virus forecast by 3%, and retail prices for used vehicles are 5% higher than pre-virus levels. So as we start looking at some of those numbers, we see that there's an enormous opportunity for pre-owned, and really puts us in a great position to take advantage of what the opportunity is and to put a game plan together to really drive us to that next level. But we have to do more than just sell used cars. Dealers need to maximize their used vehicle sales profitability. But how do we do that? As we know, the pre-owned marketplace sets the price, and dealers have very little leeway to raise prices to accommodate more gross profit. So dealers really need to maximize their used vehicle sales profitability. This is about working smart and being efficient, because every day costs you money in pre-owned, as those of you in the business know. Creating the right and most attractive inventory mix is essential to driving success, increasing share, and higher profits. For example, if I want to increase my used car profit, I want to do a great job of acquiring inventory for a decent cost to market, or CTM. And we're going to talk about that a lot in the next couple slides, so that when I price and sell my vehicle based on the market, I can earn the gross profit I need. That means that pre-owned profitability begins with making good buys. The dealer must then merchandise their inventory to bring it to market, and then I, as a dealer, must find my gross profit margin through an effective acquisition process and high, very, very strong merchandising. As a dealer, I may not have control over the market price of a pre-owned vehicle, but I do have control over what I pay to acquire that unit and how I bring it to market. Make that inventory work harder by doing 3 simple things, and this is really the art of ROI. Number 1, find customers. You already sold them. You know them. They know you. Look in your backyard. If you worked on the car, you know it best, right? It's here for service. So buy it. Use the KISS method. Keep it simple. If it's too hard to understand, it's not worth doing. Be consistent. If you're consistent and methodical about working your portfolio to find quality inventory, you'll make more money and have less of those auction fire drills, because then you're at the mercy of somebody else and you lose control. Because here's the fun part. For every piece you pick up, guess what? The customer needs to replace it. So it's a two-for-one opportunity. I call that double your pleasure and double your fun. As far as acquiring the right vehicles for your market, the best inventory stocking strategy is typically aimed to stock inventory that's reflective of what's selling in the market, right? Of course, it's adjusted for the dealer's own niche market position. For example, a Honda dealer always has a selection of CPO vehicles for every model available, irrespective of market sales information, and dealers measure over that over or under or perfectly against stocked against their sales rate by using KPI dealer day supply. This metric tells you a dealer, It tells a dealer how many days until they sell out of a particular model. It is almost always the case that dealers struggle to consistently fill every vehicle segment and price point their inventory for acquiring that at a reasonable cost to market. As the saying goes, there is no used car factory to pick up exactly what you're looking for at a reasonable cost. There's really only two ways to acquire inventory, trade or buy. And there's advantages and disadvantages to each. The digital revolution has truly redefined lead quality. But let's talk about some of the advantages and disadvantages to these two strategies. So as I think about wholesale and trade, let's talk about trade first. The advantages of trade is that it's a much better cost to market. It's typically between 75 and 80% of cost to market. There's better intelligence. Perhaps the previous customer has complete service records, and at least you can ask questions of that owner before they purchase. The disadvantages of trade is it's got a random selection of appraisals. You really have no control over what keys are going to come across your desk for an appraisal. It usually offers an insufficient opportunity to fill inventory quantity requirements and insufficient in terms of mix and vehicle segment and price points. The wholesale advantages give you an opportunity to target specific units that fill a specific inventory need. There's a larger selection nationally, and you don't even need to leave your store in today's environment. There's online wholesale purchasing. It's getting better and better and easier to access. The wholesale purchase disadvantages is that there's a higher cost to market. It's typically between 85 and 90%. And at the same time, there's low intelligence. It's limited to vehicle history report data, auction condition reports, visual inspections as it rolls through the lane. It's not like you can interview the car, like you can interview the customer in a trade environment. But there are advantages to disadvantages to these two strategies. Most importantly, identify those customers who are driving the precise vehicles you need in stock. They also have a compelling reason to listen to your proposal. Ensure your dealership's customer insights can be collected and analyzed in a single environment. Integrate data from your CRM and your DMS so you can tailor outreach to each customer. For example, if you're able to integrate your data from your CRM and your DMS, new and used vehicle inventory, and then enrich that data with customer behavior, as well as ownership journey information, by giving you the most accurate and most up-to-date information, you can create an audience of high intent buyers and communicate with them in a way that maximizes their likelihood to buy, including personalized messaging, vehicle recommendations, whether that's new or used. Remember that information is power. Know your customer's ownership journey so you can become their advisor. Solve their problem or need. That's extremely important. Solve, for example, mitigate risk. Their factory warranty has expired. find money, things like equity, save money, potentially a lower payment. Your compelling offer is really to fix the customer's problem and in turn, pick up a quality piece of inventory and sell another car at the same time. As I said, double your pleasure, double your fun. Your customers are really the gift that keeps on giving. Trades, sales, referrals, and more. Understand that customer's journey so you can become their advisor. It gives you the opportunity to meet their unique needs. Ensure your dealership's customer insights can also be collected and analyzed in a single environment. Let's make it simple. I've seen situations where people will put together 5, 6, 7 page proposals in front of customers where they put the trade appraisal, where they will put a payoff on their loan, and they'll put a lot of different things into a proposal, and the customer may get confused. And we've gone to 8 or 9 or 10 different places to gather this information, and we're trying to put it in front of the customer in a way that not only may confuse the customer, but may also confuse us as well. So integrating that data from your CRM and from your DMS into a single environment allows you to tailor that outreach to each customer. Again, you can solve that need by mitigating risk, finding money, and saving money at the end of the day. Start the conversation earlier to improve your cost to market. We talked about the fact that every day in the pre-owned market that vehicle sits on your lot, it costs you money. So if I can start my conversation with my customers that I already know, whether they bought at my store or whether they serviced at my store and didn't buy there, I have a better opportunity to move that customer towards replacing their vehicle, but also to buy something out of my inventory and to put something else in my inventory. For example, if the average investment per vehicle is $20,000, and I multiply that by just a simple 5% swing in cost of market, that's $100,000 in difference in gross profit margin. Getting to that customer a little faster allows us to create that opportunity. That's $1,000 difference in gross profit margin per vehicle. In today's fiercely competitive market, dealers need to identify those prospects early in their purchasing inventory and earn their business by delivering an exceptional dealership customer experience from the start. You can easily search for specific model years, trim levels, and more to target exactly what you need fast. So you might ask yourself, why be proactive? Because when a customer starts the purchase process, they're shopping you and everybody else. Getting to the customer earlier not only improves your CTM, but it solves the need that they have, whether it's mitigating risk, saving money, or finding money just before they become an internet lead. This allows you to pick up the trade before anyone else and sell that car by default. Let's talk about the service drive. Because one of the things that we've seen during the pandemic, especially in April and May, and even as we get into June and even into the summer, the number of customers coming in to a dealership is down. The number of internet leads may be flat or down, but the quality of the internet lead is not as strong as it was. Phone ups are also down. But the one thing we do know that even though service business has been down, especially during the spring when the pandemic was hitting harder, we do have those customers coming in for service, whether it's physically or virtually. Those customers are there. So why not talk to them? Do things simple, like a vehicle appraisal. I mean, the car's there. Here's an idea to get you to 100% of all your service customers. It's a very simple process. And all it is simply creating an offer, stapling it to the RO, to the receipt. So when the customer picks up their car, even if you can't talk to them, you put something in front of them. Set a task in your CRM to follow up in 3 days. And if you are in a position to put an offer in front of them instantly through a technology you may have, it puts you in a position to do it fast and something that you can do very efficiently. And it also puts you in a position to follow up with that customer, not only on the opportunity you put in front of them, but also to find out how their service experience went. And yes, we do survey our customers. We either text them, call them, email them for 48 to 72 hours after they've come in for service, asking them to rate us well and asking them how their experience was. But now this gives another opportunity for someone that may have not been directly connected to the repair or the servicing of that vehicle to maybe find out if there may have been something that the customer may have not wanted to say to the service side of the business, but good for you to find out so you can attack it head on. By the same token, teach your service advisors to spot the right vehicles to refer to the sales team. Here's an example. One referral can mean 3 repair orders if the factory warranty has expired. Again, that's one referral can mean 3 repair orders if that factory warranty has expired. The service defection goes up when there's nothing tethering that customer to your store. The factory warranty is that tether. It's that rope that that customer has to connect to your store. But if your service advisor refers that customer to the sales team and the sales team successfully puts that customer in another vehicle, it resets the warranty clock when they buy. The trade gets sold and has an 80% likelihood to come back to the service department for their first 3 visits. And the recon on the trade creates that third RO. So again, that customer buying the vehicle puts them back into that warranty, that factory warranty. So they're coming back. They're tethered again to the dealership. The used vehicle has a 75 to 80% chance, once it gets sold, to come back to the service department for the first 3 visits. And the reconditioning on that vehicle before it goes on the lot to get sold is that third RO. This is a powerful, powerful strategy to put in place to be able to teach your service advisors to refer the right people into your sales department so they don't feel slighted by referring somebody where they could get something off of, but putting you in a position to take advantage of those referrals, put them in a vehicle, and put yourself in a position to actually drive more business into your service department as well. Boosting profitability by improving retention. We know that during economic downturns, the service drive becomes the de facto front door to your dealership and a potential launching point for trade-in discussions. This is a prime opportunity to boost profitability by reducing customer acquisition costs, by improving customer retention. A widely accepted rule of thumb that acquiring a new customer costs 5 times that of retaining an existing one. So start with your service customer by using some sort of technology that integrates data from your DMS. You're able to more accurately identify service to sales prospects before the purchase cycle and communicate with them before their buying journey begins. If you're able to identify those pain points in a customer's ownership journey, for example, has their factory warranty expired? Could their payment on a replacement vehicle go down? Could their interest rate potentially go down? Could they save money in gas? If it's a lease, are they over miles on a lease? What's their equity position? If you can gather those pieces of information quickly and be able to put a proposal in front of a customer efficiently, it will help you improve retention because it helps you go to the right customers at the right time just before they become that internet lead. I love this line. Fixed ops number one customer is the used car department. This is often true, but by the same time, lowering those reconditioning costs, you can increase overall profitability. The average RO for a used car inspection can run as high as 10% of the total investment. So as we talked early on about those two strategies, trade and wholesale, to be able to acquire inventory, I can lower my reconditioning costs by picking up more trades because it's a known quantity for me. It's a known entity. I know more about that vehicle because I've either worked on it or I know the customer that has come to my store to buy my vehicle or service that vehicle. If I'm using the option to fill my used car lot for most of my inventory, I'm in the land of the unknown. I don't know what I'm going to see other than being able to potentially see it in the auction lane, whether it's physically or in many cases today, virtually. So I don't have the benefit of being able to know all the details behind that experience. So the reconditioning costs on vehicles that are purchased through the wholesale strategy typically are higher. So I can use my portfolio and managing my portfolio effectively to find those customers in that segment that allow me to maximize my opportunity. Analyze those reconditioning costs to improve the ROI. Approximately 70% gross profit margin comes out of fixed ops. However, you will see increased profitability with increased internal ROs for used vehicle reconditioning. That's store health. A profitable service department means I can do things on the front end of my business that I may not be able to do if I don't have a healthy service department. I've got to be able to prop that up. We all say that service is successful because it all starts with a sale, which is extremely true. But if we don't have a healthy service department and we're not fixing cars or servicing cars or running at a high RO count based on our market, it does hurt our store health, which hurts our ability to be nimble and to be flexible in a market like we're in right now, which is extremely volatile and seems to change by the day. Research that vehicle service history and VIN records for things like crashes, flood damage, frame damage, to ensure you can turn a profit on that investment. A vehicle history report can help you do that. Buy the right cars that will offset older cars with higher miles that require more work. Ensure your sales and service teams are able to quickly and efficiently identify customers, high intent buyers whose current vehicles are well positioned for reconditioning. Utilize customer insights to match prospects with relevant messaging, such as attractive trade-in offers to maximize their engagement. The one thing to keep in mind is that just like the used car, which is extremely unique, kind of like having its own DNA, very different than a new car, the customer is extremely unique as well. Their ownership journey is unique to them. So if I know what those behavior characteristics are, if I know what those behavior drivers are, at the end of the day, I can use that information to become that advisor, to become the consultant, to become the information source for that customer. If we think of it this way, we're talking about solving needs in the new market as well as the pre-owned market. By solving needs, you can take advantage of the opportunities that are there. Simplify the sales process and shorten that cycle time. When people hear the word process, many picture a 300-step exercise with decision after decision to make along the way and hundreds of pages. But the reality is that many of us don't have time for this. The easier the process is, the more it gets followed. And in this case, the faster you'll turn that inventory to make a difference. Because we said that for every day that used vehicle sits on the lot, it costs money. Things like carrying costs, depreciation, as well as value. Your entire team needs to be working in a coordinated way to reduce that cycle time. Properly managing pre-owned inventory is a daily task of discipline that requires a full team to work in coordination to reduce cycle time, get these units frontline ready and online ASAP. Every day that a vehicle ages is a detriment to money leaking out of the cash register. This is why the velocity approach to market-based pricing results in downward pressure on pricing and profitability. It's a race to retain gross profit. This allows you to really work on your business and not just in your business. Take a strategic approach. Plan things out. Put processes in place that are simple and put yourself in a position to win. This is especially true with increased competition online for the dealers outside the customer's PMA or AOI. Online, the car is the star. Buyers find the car first, and then they visit the dealer, especially in pre-owned, because a customer may be looking for something very, very specific. In the old days, they would visit the local dealer they trusted, and then they would select their pre-owned car, even if it didn't have everything they're looking for. However, the online environment has allowed the customer to be a lot more picky and a lot more selective in their approach. That's why strong merchandise really leads to strong sales. First impressions are everything. And in today's environment, virtual first impressions are critical. As an industry, we have evolved far beyond a gut feeling. It's about making those data-driven decisions, especially when it comes to pricing. Make sure you're using sources relevant and relative to your market to help you price vehicles appropriately. We know there are many out there. It's worth the investment because you're using insight to drive action. And markets today move extremely fast. As I mentioned, more volatile than ever. Personalized messaging is extremely important because you want your customer to feel like they're already in the car. The more you know about the customer's ownership journey, the better you can showcase those key features of what you're trying to sell them. And don't forget, a picture is worth a thousand words. I would not recommend skimping on quality. This is your invitation to the party. Make sure you're getting that attention with strong merchandising to give yourself an edge at the end of the day. By the same token, keep it simple. To increase that efficiency while driving sales, dealers must simplify the sales process. It starts with the very first customer touch point, and it's got to have a relevant offer. Keep in mind that pre-owned customers tend to be more price sensitive. They tend to be a little more credit challenged. They are less brand loyal. It does complicate the sales cycle. But if you're using some sort of behavior prediction to be able to quickly and efficiently make sense of complex buyer journeys to match pre-owned prospects with relevant offers, it'll maximize your engagement. Keep in mind that there are literally over 103,000 possibilities of any point in a customer's ownership journey, any data point that is. So make sure that you're maximizing the opportunity to come up with a process as well as a technology that puts you in a position to find this information quickly. For example, did the customer buy a pre-owned vehicle? If so, they are more likely to buy another one. This is a great audience to prospect proactively. So what if you could find all those people very fast who bought a pre-owned vehicle? Will the customer's payment increase by more than 20% on a new vehicle? If so, consider them pitching them on a pre-owned. It still has tons of upgrades. For example, if a customer's in a 2013 vehicle and the monthly payment on a 2020 may go up 30 or 40%, what if I put them in a 17 or an 18? It allows me to show them that there are still new features, upgrades, and it's a new car in the customer's mind. But at the same time, it puts me in a position to offer to them a much more attractive offer at the end of the day. Match those prospects with vehicles in your inventory so you can reduce the lead time, improve your profit per deal, and most importantly, turn your pre-owned inventory much faster. Transition from marketing and sales seamlessly. Keep that handoff between marketing and sales as seamless as possible. Equip your team with the same tools and customer insights to allow them to create a sales experience that is centered around each customer's individual needs. By matching prospects to the vehicles you have on hand, you're able to reduce lead time or turnaround and maximize your profit per deal. By the same token, make sure that you are targeting the right vehicles within your inventory. Put yourself in a position to highlight vehicles that may have higher miles because you need to turn those faster because they depreciate faster. Vehicles that have been sitting on your lot for a while. Sometimes it's just playing the shell game on your lot and just moving those vehicles that you need to liquidate quickly towards the front. If you're not doing that and you're keeping cars in the same place all the time, that's another strategy to put in play, especially on the vehicles you need to move. Putting internal spiffs on vehicles that you need to move with your team. Try that approach. Extremely important because we all know that the longer that vehicle sits on the lot, the more expensive it's going to be at the end of the day. As we look ahead, there's a 19.6 million vehicle decline in global manufacturing compared to 2019. That's incredible. But as I think about the numbers that we looked at early on, we saw the SAR for new cars and how that's starting to stabilize, even though it's still going to be lower than it was last year at the end of the day. And if we look at the number of used vehicles sold to the number of new vehicles, it's eclipsing 3-to-1 right now. One of those direct impacts to it has been because there's almost 20 million vehicles that have declined from a manufacturing perspective and available in the marketplace compared to the same time last year. And most of that is pandemic driven. 44% of those customers say they will use their car more often and public transportation less. This tells us a lot. Customers from large metros like New York City, Chicago, Washington, D.C., and other large metros are starting to move away from the city into a more suburban environment. For many reasons, reasons like that their job may be taking them to a more suburban environment. They may be working virtually now, so they don't need to be in the city every day. They're concerned, they're scared because of what's happening out there. So they may not be using public transportation as much just because of the migration pattern more than anything else, but there's also, like I said, a fear factor. There aren't as many people getting on public transportation and using public transportation like they did before the pandemic. By the same token, I read an article the other day that said Uber's numbers were down over $1 billion last quarter. So there aren't as many Ubers on the road, and there are less and less people getting into an Uber because they are concerned about the quality of that vehicle, but more importantly, if that vehicle is clean or not in their mind. And this is especially true with the millennial segment of the consumer population. Last month, the millennial segment became the largest consumer buying population in the country. And because they have become the largest consumer buying population in the country, and because more and more millennials are moving out of those hubs in the large cities and moving out into the suburbs or even into the country, they have to have now to be able to get us to the next place. 44% of those customers say they're going to use their car more often and public transportation less, and that is creating an enormous opportunity for used cars. 34% of U.S. consumers are considering buying a car in 2020. That's actually 44 million households, which is an enormous opportunity for us. So while we see new car numbers declining, and a lot of those things we can't control, like I was saying early on, let's talk about what we can control versus what we can't control at the end of the day. So when we look at some of the numbers as we look ahead, it's very promising. Even though we have that decline in global manufacturing, we see an opportunity to sell more people cars that may have not had them before or may have not needed them before. And we also see that there is a sentiment in the country that consumers are considering, 44 million households are considering buying that car in 2020. As we think about how we can bring all this information together, there are technologies that can do that for you. We can have an expansive data footprint that offers those predictive analytics. It allows you to uncover those opportunities through marketing, workflow, and inventory management. Okay, integration is extremely important. For example, can a technology bring you pre-owned inventory that is sourced from a common place, an industry-accepted place? Can it bring you that inventory in such a way that it's meaningful and you can be able to structure deals from that technology? Can a pre-owned customer that bought a pre-owned vehicle from you actually be mapped to a pre-owned vehicle for their replacement vehicle quickly and easily? Is it relevant? Is it smart? For example, we know that pre-owned customers are more likely to be much more payment conscious. They're much more mileage conscious. Can we put rules in place to be able to move those customers into those vehicles? And if a technology is proven through some sort of ranking, stack ranking of consumers, if it's designed for the pre-owned market to be able to give you an opportunity to drive what's there, it puts you in a great place to be able to be efficient and to use the strategies that we talked about over the last 40 minutes or so to put you in a great spot. To recap, it's all about being proactive. If you change the game, you will change the result. If you wake up tomorrow and say, I'm going to keep doing what I'm doing, and it's not working for you today, it probably won't work for you tomorrow. So put yourself in a position to be able to drive to that next level. The days of waiting for business are gone. If you build that effective outreach strategy, they will come. If you do build it, they will come. Adopt a solve the need mentality, because it does simplify the sales process. It creates that sense of urgency and relevancy. Put yourself in a position to be the advisor, to be the consultant. Don't sell the product, sell the solution. Be the advisor. And if you think about it this way, if you have a question about money and what to do next, especially in today's environment, as volatile as it's been, we've all consulted with financial advisors. If you have a question about your body or your health and what to do next, we consult with medical advisors. In those two fields, for those people to make an accurate assessment and give you good advice, they need information. Whether they ask you for information or ask you to do something to provide information, those folks need data to be able to give you advice. And in those two professions, we consider those people to be experts in their fields. And they're experts because they give you advice that we rely on. In the third largest purchase that you make in your life, which is a car, just behind a house and a college education, shouldn't we have an automotive advisor that uses data-driven insights to be able to give you the information that you need as a consumer to be able to solve that need at the end of the day? Thank you very much for joining. We're opening things up to questions. Ashley, back to you.
Fantastic. Thank you so much. What an informative presentation. As Pete mentioned, we do have a few minutes for questions. If you would like a question asked on your behalf, please type it into the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. And while we wait for questions to come in, we are going to put a few poll questions on the screen. We greatly appreciate your feedback via the polls of today's webinar. All right, Pete, questions are starting to come in, so I'll go ahead and kick this off. First question is, should I pull a vehicle history report on a trade before contacting a customer?
That's a great question, Ashley, and I'm a big believer that we don't want surprises. The worst thing we could ever want is a surprise, and I won't ask you to answer, but I'll ask a rhetorical question to the audience. How many of you have been in a position where you thought you knew what that trade was going to be, and you've done a sight unseen appraisal, and all of a sudden the customers come in and the tires are bald, or all of a sudden the customers come in and there's an accident you didn't know about. All of a sudden the customers come in and the last time the vehicle was serviced was 5 years ago and the car happens to be 5 years old. So I'm a big believer that the more I know about that customer's ownership journey, be it a vehicle history report, be it consumer insight, lifestyle, demographics, customer ownership journey, what's their payment, what's their interest rate, can it go up or down, how long have they been in the vehicle, how many payments have they made, how many payments do they have left. It's all about information at the end of the day. So absolutely, a vehicle history report is essential. And of all the stores that I've been in my career, there aren't many people that do that, to be very candid about it, because we wait until the customer comes in and then we get surprised. It doesn't take long to pull a vehicle history report. In many cases, there's software out there that allows you to pull that vehicle history report in a simple click or even see a snapshot by just hovering over a logo. So put yourself in a position where you take a glance at that vehicle history before your customer comes in so you know what to expect and there's no surprises at the end of the day.
Fantastic, thank you. Next question that's come in is, how does CPO differ from pre-owned?
The basic difference between CPO and pre-owned is a pre-owned vehicle, and let's say that I'm a Toyota dealer, and I'm just picking on Toyota, just because it's the first one I thought of. And I have 20 Toyotas on the ground in my pre-owned fleet, and let's say that 10 of those are CPO. CPO, in case you don't know, stands for Certified Pre-Owned. What that is a program through the manufacturer that requires the dealer to do certain things to get that vehicle certified as a pre-owned vehicle, whether it's 110-point inspection or whether it's, you know, making sure that things are, you know, A, B, and C line up, whatever the case may be, that puts us in a position to be able to offer that vehicle as a certified pre-owned vehicle. In some cases, there may also be benefits from a warranty perspective on that vehicle as well. The factory warranty could potentially be extended. There could be other benefits to certifying that vehicle. So the basic difference between a CPO and a non-CPO vehicle is that a CPO has gone through the process of certification at the dealer level following the manufacturer requirement to put that vehicle in a certified position. Typically, those vehicles will sell for more money, and typically those vehicles will bring a higher gross, and typically those customers will rate your store much higher on the surveys that they receive. So those are some benefits of CPO versus non-CPO as well.
Great. Next question is, should the philosophy on days supply of inventory be adjusted during these times?
I'm sorry, I only heard about half of that.
Sorry about that. Should the philosophy on days supply of inventory be adjusted during these times?
It's interesting. That's an interesting question. You know, and I guess I look at it two ways. Okay, the first way I can look at it and say, you know what? If I look at some of the numbers that I was going through as far as what's happened to used vehicle prices at the auction, as well as in the marketplace, have gone up 5% since these unprecedented times, then one might say, well, maybe I don't need to change my day supply strategy because I'm actually going to get more for the car at the end of the day. But I'm a big believer that it doesn't matter. You know, maybe auction prices are a little higher. It could be that book values and trade values are a little higher. Whether you're using trade value A, B, or C, it really doesn't matter. But at the end of the day, I want to be able to turn my inventory as fast as possible. The more turns I have on my lot at the end of the day, the more profitable I'm going to be. So I don't know that I would adjust or not adjust, but I would have the same philosophy every day, pandemic or not. I've got to move my inventory the fastest way possible and put inventory on my lot that's the most attractive as possible. Some I have control over, some I don't have control over, but I've got to have a strategy that's going to turn my inventory as quickly as possible. So as I look at the numbers, it doesn't matter what the pandemic says or it doesn't say. If you keep your strategy consistent, it's going to put you in a position to turn that inventory faster. If you're failing and you have cars on your lot with a high day supply, then absolutely you should think about changing your strategy. But if you're not and it's working, continue in the same path. Because pandemic or not, we know that cars historically depreciate. So I've got to turn my inventory faster.
Absolutely. To follow up on that, you know, what is the strategy to sell more used over certified?
The strategy to sell more used over certified? It all depends on what your strategy is as a store. So if your strategy as a store is to sell more in-brand versus non-in-brand vehicles, so for example, back to my Toyota example, since I'll pick on them today. If I am a Toyota dealer and I have 90% of my pre-owned inventory in Toyotas, you know, I want to try to certify as many of those as possible because I know I'm going to do well. But if I'm in a market where maybe Toyota doesn't sell as well as Ford, for example, then I want to put more non-brand vehicles or off-brand vehicles on my lot. So that puts me in a position to sell more vehicles. So I've got to be able to know what my market does versus what's on my lot. It's a combination of what I can get on my lot as well as what's in the market to be able to get me to that next level and figure out what I'm going to do from a CPO versus a non-CPO perspective. But any vehicle that I have that's in my brand, Toyota in my example, I want to try and certify those vehicles as often as I can because I know I'm going to pick up more gross, I'm going to close those much faster, and I'm going to get higher survey scores at the end of the day. But really understanding what's selling in your market from a brand perspective and a model perspective is extremely important before you can even begin to decide what CPO versus non-CPO is really all about.
All right. Next question is, should I floor plan my used cars?
Great question. That's a tough one because we're in a tough environment. Cash is king at the end of the day. So the more cash I have, the more of a king I can be. However, we know that when we floor plan vehicles, we're really relying on somebody else's money that we've got to pay for at the end of the day. If at all possible, keeping your used vehicle inventory as liquid as possible allows you the most flexibility in the market that we have today. Because if I need to get my hands on cash quickly, because there's another downturn, for example, and I haven't floor planned my used vehicles, that puts me in a position to turn my cars a little faster. I may not be able to get as much money for them, but I'm not as reliant on having to take care of a debt that I have in floor planning that vehicle, so I can still maximize the opportunities. So should you floor plan your vehicles? I'm a pretty big believer that that's not the answer to ultimate liquidity, but it really depends on your own situation at your store. Having dealt with a lot of at-risk stores in my career, sometimes we had to floor plan as a bridge to get us to that next level. So it's really examining your own position and taking a look at it. But if you're relatively profitable in your service department and you're breaking even in your new car department, I would try to keep my used cars as liquid as possible because it gives me that ultimate flexibility at the end of the day, turn cash if I need to. And in today's environment, being as volatile as it is, it could put us in a better position to be able to keep ourselves as liquid as possible and keep our cash flow going as good as well as possible.
All right, I have about one question left. So if you do want a question asked on your behalf, please feel free to type it into the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. But the last question that I have currently is, how do I find which customers of mine I should be calling to buy their car?
Couple different things you can do, okay? So which customers you want to look at is really dependent on a couple of different things. The first thing I want to ask myself is, what do I need on my lot? You know, what is selling well that I don't have? And I'm going to keep using Toyota since I'm staying on that manufacturer today. If I need Camrys on my lot because my Camrys are doing really, really well, then it puts me in a position to look for people in Camrys today to be able to make outreach to those folks to try to buy their vehicle or to try to get them in to not only buy their vehicle, but to replace the vehicle that they have. I also want to ask myself and look at some history at my store and say, you know what? What's been selling model year-wise at my store? Do I do really well with, let's say, 16, 17, 18 vehicles, but I don't do so well with 15s and 14s, for example? So then I want to take that to the next step and say, okay, I want to bring in Camrys, in my hypothetical example, and I want to look at 16, 17s, and 18s. And by the same token, I may want to ask myself that third question that says, well, what about customers that have been in their vehicle at least 2.5 years? Because that's a customer that probably is in a either break even or potentially an equity position. So that helps me from a flexibility standpoint. And then lastly, I want to ask myself, how many people in my portfolio have more than a year left for car payments? Because I certainly don't want to call somebody and I see all of a sudden, I can get this vehicle. But I call them and they're down to their last two payments on their loan. And they tell me, well, I'm just going to wait till I pay it off because I don't want car payments. How many times have we heard that? So again, it's back to being strategic and using data-driven insight to be able to get you to that next level. So just to recap it very quickly, I want to be able to look at what's selling at my store model-wise, what's selling at my store model year-wise, people that have been in their vehicle at least 2.5 years, and people that have more than a year left of car payment. If I can do those four things, I can find an audience of customers that gives me that low-hanging fruit that I can make outreach to and make a lot of deals off of.
Fantastic. Well, that is all the time we have for today. If you have additional questions that we didn't get to or you think of after the webinar has concluded, we of course invite you to connect with our presenter. His contact information is on the screen now. And as a quick reminder, this webinar along with other resources are available to you and your entire team as a free member benefit on nada.org/education. On behalf of NADA and Automotive Mastermind, thank you all for joining us. Have a great day.